You're listening to the Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper. Good evening, folks. First off, I want to alert you. Please don't miss tomorrow night's broadcast. No matter what you may think of tonight's broadcast, tomorrow night's broadcast is the one that you need to catch. You're going to hear some music you've never heard before. You're going to hear a lot of things that you've needed to hear for a long, long time. You're going to be reacquainted with a lot of things that are near and dear to your hearts if you are truly American. And it's going to reacquaint you with your with who you are, with what you are, with where you came from, with what it all means. And so please don't miss that. That's tomorrow night. Tonight is a sort of my night with this. Tomorrow night is going to be the real thing. Tonight is sort of my night with this. And I hope you will beg my indulgence, as I was sort of inspired to do this by someone that I truly love and care about. And so My whole mind and heart and everything were just sort of opened today. And so I want you to listen to what I have to say. And as always, you are not required to agree with anything that I believe in or that I say. And remember, tonight is not fact, it's not history, it's me. And you might be interested in hearing it, you may not. If you're not, please, you know, change your station and go somewhere else. If you are, please stay tuned, because I'm going to tell you my rendition of what this is all about. And as always, listen to everyone, read everything, believe nothing, unless you can prove it in your own experience, in your own true research. And I hope your research is always conducted under due diligence. Otherwise, it's not really true research. You all know that. So, without any further ado, stick around. I think you might find tonight's broadcast interesting. In any case, you'll get to know me a little bit better, that's for sure.
Spacious skies, for amber.
You know, that song is one of my earliest memories. It's not my earliest. The earliest memories I have are of my family, my mother, things around the house. But that's one of my earliest memories of moving out from my home into the wide, wide world as a very, very, very little boy. Another one is saying the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag each morning in school, every morning. Anyone who had ever participated in that exercise could never possibly forget it, because it was the only thing, aside from some prayers in some classrooms, that was absolutely mandatory throughout our life. Every classroom that we ever entered into, in the morning, the first class of the day, we had to rise and recite the Pledge of Allegiance. It is absolutely impossible that any of us could ever forget it, because it happened every single school day, every morning of every school morning of our entire school life until we left school and went into either the workplace or university or college. And so these things are ingrained within us. We could no more dispense of these things than we could dispense of a finger or a toe or an ear. They are part of us. They are ingrained. It is something that we learned through repetition throughout our life. When I was a very, very little boy, I remember learning really quickly that my life was somehow different from the lives of my playmate companions in certain circumstances. For instance, when I went to kindergarten in Long Beach, California, my father was a member of the United States Army Air Force. All the other children were children of people who worked in banks and people who worked in newspapers and people who drove buses and things like that. I didn't understand then how much different my life would be, but I knew that my life was different, because they all had an understanding of what each of their fathers did, but they had no conception in this world about what my father did when I told them his position in our society, as much as I knew to tell them, which at that time wasn't very much. Then my father was transferred to some big Air Force or Army base. At that time, it was not the Air Force. Some big Army base up in Illinois. Or maybe it was the Air Force. I don't know. But he was transferred to some big Army base up in Illinois. And we rented a house in a little town called O'Fallon. Some of you who live in Illinois may know where O'Fallon is. It was a beautiful home with a huge cherry tree in the backyard. I remember it. And the entire countryside was lush with trees and vegetation. In the summertime, the fireflies took over the countryside. It was heaven for children. There were ponds, and they had that pond smell that you don't smell anymore today. And there were fish in those ponds, and turtles, and snakes, and big, giant night crawlers. If you dug next to the pond, you could come up with these huge worms with which to fish with. And there were snapping turtles, which were terrifying because of the tales that were told about how they chopped off the finger of the last suspecting child who stuck his hand beneath the surface of the pond. I remember all those tales. It was also my first, and this is fitting for this broadcast, as you will come to discover, it was my first encounter with a bully. And I mean a real bully. I don't remember the name of the school that I attended in O'Fallon, Illinois, but I remember to this day the face of my first grade teacher. She was a wonderful woman, kind. I don't remember her ever becoming angry with me or any other person in our class. She taught us, she helped us, she corrected us. We learned from her, and we learned an awful lot. When I first began attending that school, I would go in the morning, and my mother would always give me this little brown paper bag to carry that contained my lunch. And on the first day of school, I remember being confronted by three boys, all three of whom were bigger than me, and they wanted my lunch, and I refused to give it to them. Two of them grabbed me by the arms and held me, while the third, whom I later was nicknamed Squirrel. I don't know why his nickname was Squirrel. I never learned what his real name was, nor do I know the names of his two confederates. But Squirrel began to pummel me with his fists, particularly about the stomach and the solar plexus area, and soon I was rendered incapable of resistance. And he took my lunch. And this became the norm every morning, until one morning I went to school. I managed to get there early. I gave my lunch to a friend to hold. I was determined that this was never going to happen to me again. I waited until Squirrel and his two buddies came, and they were waiting for me to present myself at the school gate. I walked up behind Squirrel, and I hit him on the shoulder real hard. He swirled around, and I lit into him with both fists as hard as I could, and I pummeled his face until he was bleeding from the mouth and from the nose. And from that date onward, I was never bothered again by Squirrel and his two buddies, nor did I see them preying upon anyone else. And I learned a lesson that day that you cannot allow yourself to be bullied, ever. You cannot allow yourself to come under the specter of tyranny. You cannot ever allow yourself to be the object of despotism. Now, I didn't understand all of that at that age. I just knew that if I could win with him one time, he wouldn't bother me again. I knew that instinctively. And that became a pattern throughout my life because my father was a military officer. He was an Air Force officer. And we were only at, and I think it was Chanute. That name comes Chanute Air Force Base or Army Air Force Base in Illinois. But we were only there for my first grade year. And then we moved back to California. And my father was sent to the Philippines, and we were not allowed to go with him. And for the next year, I spent my second grade in an elementary school in Long Beach, California. What I had learned in Illinois served me well, and I had no problems with any of the students in the school whatsoever at all, because any instant, when anybody began to pick on me or make fun of me or try to, by coercion, elicit something from me, I very quickly confronted them and smacked them as hard as I could in the nose, and they never, ever did it again. And I made a lot of friends. And I had a wonderful time there. Then my father returned from the Philippines, and we were once again transferred. And so he had to go ahead, as always. That's always the way it happened. And then we followed. At that time, I understood that we lived in a free country, but I didn't really know what that meant. I was just a little boy. But I understood very clearly that weakness meant enslavement. I already knew that at that very young age. My father was transferred to the Azores Islands off the coast of Portugal in the Atlantic Ocean. Some people say that they are the remnants, the last remnants of the continent of Atlantis. I say bullshit. They're the peaks of very tall volcanoes that have erupted from the seafloor. It's very clear. But nevertheless, my mother, myself, my brother, and my sister got our passport pictures taken together. My mother had one passport for all of us. All of us were in one picture. And we took the Santa Fe Super Chief from Los Angeles to Chicago. What a great experience that was. And I have to tell you, that was sometime in the 40s. It was an incredible journey. It lasted about 3 days. And I don't remember whether it was two or three nights. We were on the train. We had our sleeping compartment. We ate in the dining car. We got to go sit in the observation car. And we met a lot of people who were traveling. And it wasn't like today at all. Everyone dressed. Everyone wanted to present their very best appearance for everybody, even if they didn't have the means to purchase suits and the kind of dresses that they might see in the magazines. They wore whatever they had that was the very best that they had. And so did we. My mother would not let us leave our compartment without being dressed to the T. And it was that way throughout my life. And it was an experience. It made everything special. Not like today, where you get on the train and you might be sitting next to someone who's wearing a suit and tie, and across the aisle is someone wearing a pair of shower clogs, a t-shirt, and short shorts. It's not special at all. It's taken down to the lowest common denominator, and it's degraded, debased. Everything is. But that's not the subject of tonight's broadcast. When we reached Chicago, we caught another train, which took us to some place on the East Coast, and I think it was New York City. I think it was New York City. And we disembarked, met my father. We got on another train that took us to Massachusetts, and then we went to Westover Field, and from there we flew on a military propeller-driven aircraft across the Atlantic Ocean to Lajes Field in the Azores. These are the memories of my young, boyish life. In that airplane, there were no seats like you find on modern airliners today. They were what were called bucket seats. They were like nets. And there were rows of nets going up along the side of the aircraft. You could either sit in the net or you could lay down and go to sleep. They were called bucket seats. For our meals, we had box lunches, which contained sandwiches, which were in the beginning fresh and delicious, and had a few other things there. I forget what the garnishments and other things were, but we had little cartons of milk. And toward the end of the trip, they became hard and crusty and dried out because there were no modern facilities for the preservation of food on airplanes. And our flight was long. From Westover Field on the East Coast to Lodge's Air Force Base on the island of Terceira in the Azores in the Atlantic off the coast of Portugal and Spain. I don't remember exactly how long it took us, but I remember being on that plane all day and sleeping all night and being on that plane part of another day without refueling, without landing. I don't remember what kind of a plane it was, but it was a big plane with multiple engines. And in those years, right after World War II, it could have been one of several, but I'm not even going to take a guess because I don't know. But I can tell you that when we landed in the Azores, there was no base housing available for this family. And so my father rented a mansion miles away in a village called Fonte de Bastard, which literally means the Fountain of the Bastards. I don't know where it got that name. If you look at the island of Terceira Azores and you have a map, you will see exactly where that village is. And the center of the village, the largest house in that village, my father rented. It had three floors, including a basement. Each floor had balconies, and it was surrounded by a huge wrought iron fence. It had whitewashed stone enclosures in the back of the yard for chickens and pigs and any kind of livestock that you wanted to raise. It had a huge raised garden, which my mother brought to life like magic. And it was haunted. It really was. And in the basement were huge, gigantic oak barrels full of wine, but aging, and had been aging for years, and were going to age for years beyond the time that we were there. And we were there for 3 years, and nobody ever came and emptied those barrels of their wine. At that time, I knew nothing of what that meant. Underneath, the whole structure was a huge cistern which collected water from the rain, and it was always full of the most wonderful tasting water that you've ever seen in your life. And we learned about another people. We learned about another place. We learned about another culture. We learned how to play with children without speaking their language, and over a period of time, we began to learn their language, and soon we could converse with those children, and they could converse with us. And I was amazed at the contrast between their life and ours. And I want to tell you about that so that you will learn to even on the most remotest scale, appreciate what you have that was given to you by the founding fathers in this nation simply because you were born here and for no other reason.
Thank you.
ladies and gentlemen, the people that we lived with in that village were, I'm sure, according to their standards, very well off. There was a man who owned the general store, which was down the hill from us. We could look down from off the balcony of our living room, and we could see Connect's store. His name was Connect. And then the huge Catholic cathedral, and then off in the distance, the ocean. Connect was probably the richest man in town besides my father, and we could never understand that because my father was not rich. My father was a lieutenant in the United States Army Air Corps. Or United States Air Force. I'm not sure which it was at that time. And it doesn't matter because I'm recounting my memories and this is the way I remember it. My father was a lieutenant. In those days, a lieutenant, even with a family, a wife, and three children, according to our standards of living, didn't make dip. He was a poor man himself. But in that country, my father on his salary was wealthy beyond his own imagination, was able to rent the only huge mansion in this entire village, was looked up to by the villagers as the patron of the village. When they needed something, they came to my father, which I'm sure irritated Connect to no end, because up until the time my father arrived, he was the man who had the influence and the power. This is the way I remember it. The name could be different, but I remember it as Connect. I don't know why. I met a little boy. His name was Joaquin, which meant Jackie, as I learned in later years. And the way I met him is he lived across the alley from our home. And he would climb up over the wall into our grounds while we were asleep or away. And he would steal our toys. It wasn't long until I realized that our toys were being stolen, little cars and toys and dolls and things that we had. And we didn't have a lot because my father didn't have a lot of money to spend. You see, he was considered to be a rich man by the standards of the village in which we lived. But when it came to purchasing things for the family from the Sears catalog, we had no money. We had no money. And the only time we ever received toys was on Christmas. And it was never a lot of toys. When my father made trips to other countries or back to the United States on airplanes as a pilot, he would bring us back things like classic comic books, Donald Duck comic books, things like that. And one time I was standing on the balcony and I looked across the alley and I saw on top of a roof this elaborate city and roads all mapped out with stones and little rock walls and our toys. And so I immediately realized that whoever had built that on top of that roof had been stealing our toys. And I went over there, climbed up on top of that roof, and there was a little boy who understood that he was wrong and that he had stolen our toys. But at the same time, he was full of pride. And we confronted each other on that roof and we pushed each other around for a few minutes until I realized that what I saw on this roof was the only thing that he had ever had in his entire life that he could call his own, even though he had stolen a good portion of it from us. And I wasn't going to let him get away with that. I picked up every single toy that belonged to us, except for one, and I gave it to him. I took the rest of the toys back home. And every time we got a new toy, I would give him an old toy. And when he get tired of the oldest toy that he had received from us, he would come and give it back. And so we arrived at an understanding that he wasn't a thief, really. Down in his heart, he was never a thief. And I think he had intended never to keep all that he had taken from us, and that he was embarrassed at having been discovered. And so we made a peace and a friendship that lasted the whole time that we lived there. Now these people in their ignorance were very, very happy. If my family had never come to that village, they would never have known that they had lacked anything. That little boy would not ever have known that there were toys such as those that we possessed. And his life would have been much happier. There are things that we do in this world that are good for society, and things that we do that are absolutely terrible for humankind. The worst thing that you could ever do for a remote population of Aboriginal humans on some island anywhere in this world or deep within some forest is to show them what they do not have. For in doing that, you render their idyllic, happy life where they have come to terms with nature all of a sudden extinct. And they want what they cannot possibly have, what they have not the means to obtain. There's no way in the world that they could hope to obtain the education within their lifetime to be able to climb up to the level of that which they have learned we possess, that all of a sudden they covet, that they instinctively understand they cannot have. Unless it's a gift. And sometimes these things are gifts. And yes, there's a lot that we can give them. Medicine. We can give them education, but we have to understand that just because we give them education, we cannot show them all of the greatness of modern society, because there are so many of them that cannot ever hope to have it. It's for their children or their grandchildren. And so we destroy societies and peoples. I learned this at a young age, and my life didn't change because I spent my entire young life moving from country to country, Air Force Base to Air Force Base with my father. I actually graduated from high school at Yamato Air Station in Japan. The only other time that I spent the entire growing up period of my life was in Midwest City, Oklahoma, where I attended Monroney Junior High School. When it was brand new, built, I was the first, along with many other students, the first young people to attend that junior high school. But I learned early on what it meant to be something other than an American. I learned what it meant. I learned what our responsibility was to these people. Even though no one sat down and taught me those things, I instinctively knew it. And where in my young years I might take advantage of it on occasion, where it might benefit me, I never ever took advantage of it where it would destroy their society. But I saw many others who would. We have been so lucky in this nation, and most of us have no conception, no idea, not the remotest inkling of what that means. Because most Americans have never visited foreign countries in their entire life. When they do, they go to places like Paris, Berlin, London, Geneva, Mexico City, Rio de Janeiro. And while they're there, they ignore the poor, the beggars, the little children in the streets competing to try to shine your shoes. They overlook that, thinking that's an aberration, but it's not. It's an indication of the extreme poverty that lies just beyond the surface, where in those great cities it is concealed by the authorities so that you, the tourist, will never see it, never understand it, never know anything about it. You don't see shoeshine boys in the United States of America. If that kind of poverty existed here, you would. You used to, in the early days of this country, when there was that kind of poverty in this nation. But unlike this nation, where at one time there was that kind of poverty, in these other nations there's never been the opportunity to rise above it, as there has always been in this country. For all people, I don't care what your race or religion is, and don't give me all this crap about slavery and the black experience and I was a Jew and I was discriminated against and the Irish thing and all that kind of crap. All that was overcome in this country by people who truly understood the way this nation worked and realized the ability to rise above it. And eventually the people of this country. Let me tell you this, it wasn't just the blacks who rose up and overturned discrimination. You see, because the blacks were a very small minority without a tremendous wave of support throughout this nation, amongst all races and religions, it could never have happened. It had to happen. It was going to happen. It did happen. And it could not have happened anywhere else under the same circumstances. We failed to realize the supreme significance of having been born in the greatest nation that's ever existed upon the face of this earth, the only nation that ever granted to the common man freedom. Freedom. The only nation in the history of the world. The nation that sparked revolutionary movements throughout the world. The nation that created the movement to overthrow kings, queens, monarchs, emirs, sultans, emperors from off their thrones. From that historic moment to this. And that's really the whole purpose for the whole thing to begin with. For there's been a grand design to the construction of the United States of America since before the first settlers came to these shores. And if you don't believe that, read Bacon's The New Atlantis, and then go back in history and read Plato's Atlantis, and then go back and read Bacon's The New Atlantis again, and then began to read the writings of the Founding Fathers, read their references to the secret destiny of America, to the divine inspiration of the founding of this nation. Read their plans for the new world. Go back before that to Europe. During the first settlements sent to this country, and read writings which echoed previous to the writings of the Founding Fathers, many of the same sentiments and the same words and same references to the New World and the New Atlantis. And you may begin to get some kind of an inkling as to what I am referring to. If you really want to get into it in depth, go to my series on Mystery Babylon, and it will open your eyes beyond anything that you ever felt they could be opened before. For the first time in the history of the entire world, man sat down and ignored the history of the world and said, we don't give a damn about the divine right of rulership of kings. We don't care about our subservient status to aristocracy and royalty. We recognize something that's never been recognized before in the history of the world as a God. God created man in his own image, and God created man with certain unalienable rights, which we recognized. And they enumerated those rights, and they created a government to recognize the supremacy and sovereignty of the individual above kings and queens and governments under the laws of God, with certain unalienable rights recognized and protected by the state. And they created the United States of America. And never in the history of the world was there so much opportunity, so much promise, so much happiness, so much work, so much risk. And in attempting to achieve that happiness, that equality, that place that every man believes that he has in this world and strives to obtain, there was always a risk of sudden death, a risk of having everything that one had ever obtained by the sweat of his brow stolen in a second, the risk of being crippled or maimed. There was a risk, but without that risk, without the risk, the great achievement that the men and women who lived in this country, who achieved and accomplished way beyond what any other country has ever achieved in the history of the world, would never have come to pass. Never. If they had laid down and said, we're the working class and we're the victims of the bourgeoisie and the rich, and we need to be taken care of, and we need to foment revolution and overthrow this republic so that we can have some kind of a socialist bullshit crap state, so that the state can take care of us and make sure that we don't have any risk and we don't have to work for anything. It never would have happened. None of it would have ever happened. Nothing would have happened. There would never have been the tremendous success in this nation that occurred over all those years. There would never have risen up in this world a middle class, which in the history of the world had never existed. A middle class. People who had achieved wealth beyond their parents' dreams. Even though, by modern-day standards, It could be considered a modest degree of wealth. It was nevertheless something that the common man had never even hoped to dream of in the history of this world. They achieved it. And every generation afterward, the children lived a better life than their parents, unless they were totally incompetent, fell victim to some terrible disease or some accident, or fell into a life of crime. This was the Valhalla, the heaven, the promised land for all of the oppressed, the poor people of the world. And from every single nation upon the face of this earth, every single poor person looked to America for his salvation. And they tried with all their might, many of them dying in the process, to get here in order to found for themselves that promise for their children, that their children would live better off than they did, and their children's children would live even better than their children had lived. And only in this country was that possible out of all of the nations in the entire world. And it began with something that you're going to hear extensively about tomorrow night, called the Unanimous Declaration of the 13 Colonies. Now today known as the Declaration of Independence. Now that's when it officially began legally and lawfully on a piece of paper, which to this day is the founding document in law, still valid today as it was then, of the United States of America. There were things that happened before that that set the stage. People lost their lives before that document was penned. And we've talked about some of those things before on this broadcast. But tonight I wanted to just give you some insight into my understanding of where I am in relationship to the world as a citizen born in the state of California, with my domicile in the state of Arizona, being a citizen of those two states by virtue of those two things, a part of the United States of America, and what it means to me. You see, I've been all around the world, not just as a boy, but in the military. I was in the Air Force for 4 years and in the Navy for over 10, actually in the Air Force for over 4. 4 active duty, about 8 months or so as part of the Air Force Reserve. I am not anti-government, to the contrary. No one in this world loves our government more than me, nor could they, in their wildest dreams, ever love it more than me. As much maybe, but never more. But you have to understand exactly what this government is. The government is the Constitution for the United States of America, the Bill of Rights, and the lawful amendments thereto. That sets out the structure of our government. It sets out the limitations to that government and grants it very few, very limited powers. All of the powers fall to the states, and if not exercised by the states, then to us, we, the people. Most Americans have no conception of any of this. They don't understand it. They don't know anything about it. They don't know their special place in this universe. They have no conception, no idea that they are sovereign kings and queens in their own right, and that the government was created to serve us, to recognize our rights and to protect them. Well, I know that. I will never forget it. And as long as I'm alive, I'm never, ever in my life going to allow you to forget it either. So, ladies and gentlemen, don't miss tomorrow night's broadcast. It's all about the unanimous declaration of the 13 states. Or, excuse me, the unanimous declaration of the 13 colonies, which today we recognize as the Declaration of Independence. That's what you're celebrating on the 4th of July. It's not a holiday to go out and have a picnic. The fireworks aren't to light up the sky. It's to remind you of the death, the destruction, the dangers, the tremendous sacrifices of those who participated in the Revolutionary War. And so, there you have it. And, folks, I want you all to be here tomorrow night, because we're going to discuss that at great length. Great length. And I hope that in some way I've laid some kind of a foundation for me in this discussion, so that maybe you'll have some understanding of what I'm all about and why I think it is so important. And maybe, just maybe, you'll think that it is equally important. Good night. God bless each and every single one of you. Please don't miss tomorrow night's broadcast. In light of what I discovered in my youth, folks, it's always amazed me that people in this nation actually have the audacity to believe that they're poor when they have no idea what real poverty really is. The poorest person in this nation, in most other countries of this world, would be considered to be very well off. Now, don't take my word for that. Go check it out. We're all very fortunate. We're also a bunch of silly wimps, cowards, pussies. We haven't got the guts to understand that even in the worst state that you can imagine in this country, we have the opportunity that no one in any other country has ever had, and that is to climb out of it, to become whatever we personally are capable of making of ourselves. And that is the American dream.
Amen. Cheyenne, Cheyenne, where will you be camping tonight? Lonely man.